Last week we talked about sex, and we talked about sex being not casual but serious. And we talked about the ramifications of that. We spent some time in Paul's letter talking about how important it is to think about the seriousness of sex and how it doesn't just involve the physical part of us, but it also involves the emotional and spiritual part. So today we're going to talk about the power of sex. Now, I'm assuming everyone in here has shot a gun before, right? Anybody in here not shot a gun before? Johnny's never shot a gun. That's too bad, Johnny. But the first time I shot a gun, I was 10, and my dad had a rifle. It was a little 22 rifle. Well, to me at 10, it was a big 22 rifle. And we went shooting, and he put it in my arms, told me to hold it, and I held it. And he stepped away, and he said, just pull the trigger. And I remember how hard it was for my little hands to pull that trigger, and I was concentrating so much on pulling the trigger that I wasn't concentrating on where the gun was. So much like happened to you, I had it up here, and when I finally pulled the trigger, the whole thing went like this and came down on my eye, blackened my eye. Yeah, black. Well, I was 10. Black in my eye. We're not all great like you, Joel. And so it blackened my eye, but I realized at that point the power of the gun. And then as I got older, I realized the power of a gun or a weapon is it can do good because it can defend you, or you can kill food or whatever that is, or it can do evil. And we've seen that as well. So sex is kind of the same way. You know, girls use the power of sex to get attention by what they wear or how they act. Guys use the power of sex by maybe what they say, or they realize what it might get them from a girl. It may get them attention, or it may get them notoriety, or they may fit in with other guys. Girls use sex in order to draw closer to somebody. They have an emotional attachment to it. They think that if they have sex with a guy, that he's going to love them more. Guys use sex because of the physical part of it many times. It feels good, and they get immediate gratification out of it. So sex has this power for good, okay? But it also has this power for very, very bad. And if used in the wrong context, it has the power to really be bad or destroyed. Pornography is the same way. If you're looking at stuff on the computer or on your phone or magazines or on television or whatever it is, it has this power to remove you from reality and sit you into this virtual world that's not real. So today I want to talk about, when it comes to sex, who has the real power. And I want to read a Bible story to you. Most of you guys have probably heard the story of Samson. And you know the story of Samson and Delilah. And so we're going to spend some time this morning talking about how the power of sex happened in the life of Samson. Now, Samson, the story of Samson is in the book of Judges. And at this particular time in Israel, they had come out of Joshua. All right, Joshua was kind of the last leader. You know, there was Moses, and then Joshua kind of took over, and he was kind of the last leader of Israel. And once Joshua passed away, Israel entered into this time of really having no set government. They had no real leader. So they went out and got these people, these men called judges. Now, we think of judges differently than judges actually were back then. We think of judges as people who stand in a black robe and rule over crimes or in a courtroom. Well, these judges were actually kings, but they weren't kings in a bloodline sense. They were actually just appointed. And they had the same abilities as kings did. They ruled and they set rules and laws and everything for the land. And they would pick people that had extraordinary gifts and talents. And so Samson was one of these guys. Samson had this extraordinary strength that God had given him. He was the kind of dude that you wouldn't want to mess with. I mean, he was a pretty big guy, what they say, and he had this unbelievable amount of strength, and he could hurt people and move people and do what he needed to do, and people feared him, and that's what they wanted from judges at this particular time. But one of the things about Samson that stood out is not only did he have this strength, not only did he rule and have this power, But he also would succumb to the power of sex or the power of manipulation. Okay? And that's what happens in his relationship with Delilah. So I'm going to read to you in chapter 16, verse 6. It says, "So Delilah said to Samson, 'Please tell me where your great strength lies and how you might be bound that one could subdue you.'" Samson had fallen for Delilah, who was part of the Philistines, who were enemies of Samson's people. So there was already a problem between Samson's family, who basically disregarded her and said you couldn't be with her, but he had this infatuation with her. And the Philistines were out to destroy the Israelites and Samson's kingdom, so they went to Delilah and said, "All right, find out where this guy gets his strength from. We want to know what makes this guy tick and work, because we want to attack, and we feel like if we can overthrow this guy and we can find his weakness, then we can gain control over the Israelites." And so Delilah agreed to do it for money. So she asked him the first time, "Where do you get your strength from?" And he answers her and said, "If they bind me with 7 fresh bowstrings that have not been dried, then I shall become weak and be like any other man." And so they had a plan to find out what his weakness was, and then she would let the Philistine men who were hiding in his home know about it, and they would come and attack him. So he says, "Well, get these 7 bowstrings and tie me up and make sure that they're strong enough to hold me, and I won't be able to get out of them. I'll be like any other man." And then the lords of the Philistines brought up to her 7 fresh bowstrings that had not been dried, and she bound him with them. Now she had the men lying in ambush, as I said, in an inner chamber, and she said to them, "The Philistines are upon you, Samson." But he snapped the bowstrings. Well, he lied to her. And in fact, he lied to her a couple of more times in telling her ways that they could take his strength. Well, finally, she gets him to confess. He says, "If you cut my hair, that's where my strength is." It was his gift that God had given him. In fact, had given to his parents and said, "Do not ever cut his hair. That's his strength." Back then, you would see in the Old Testament that God would tell parents or tell people to do certain things or not do certain things in line of obedience. He would test them to see if they would obey him. Sort of like what happens with us today. God gives us rules and things to follow, and he says to us, now, many of us, if we cut our hair, doesn't mean we're going to lose our strength, but he says there are these laws and these things that we should follow, and if we follow them and obey them, then good will happen. But if we don't obey them, then bad will happen. That's kind of what he was saying to Samson. So they had made this covenant with God not to cut Samson's hair. Well, he tells her the third time, "If you cut my hair, that's where I'll lose my strength." And so he falls asleep, she cuts his hair, and the Philistines come and grab him, and they capture him, and he truly loses his strength. Now, how does this story relate to what we're talking about today? Well, Samson, this strong man who felt like he had all this ability to fight anything, could not fight his urge or desire and the power that this woman had over him. This sexual desire that he had. Because that's what she did. She used maybe what she was wearing or the way she talked, or she even told him, "If you love me, if you'll lay with me, if you love me that much, then you would tell me where your strength lies." She manipulated him and used the power of sexual desire to manipulate him. We do this all the time. We see the power that sex has, and whether we consciously or subconsciously use it to get what we want. Guys will say things to girls in order to manipulate them into thinking or doing things that they don't want to do, much what Delilah did. Delilah will wear things or say things in order to gain Samson's desire and to take hold of his desire. So we do this all the time. Now, the funny thing about this is you would think that after 2 times, Samson would have caught on to what was happening and never told her, because he knew what she was doing. Because every time that she asked him, what would gain his strength, and he lied to her, and they would she would do that to him, the Philistine soldiers would come out of the closets, and he would defeat them. So you would think he would catch on to what's going on, but he didn't. This power of this sexual desire that he had overcame him. And it happens to us, I think, lots of times, especially as men, that we may not go through the act of sex. You may not be actively having sex with a girl, but this desire that we have within us can overcome us. You know, it could be 3 o'clock in the morning, you're sitting in front of the computer and you start to find yourself going to websites and looking at things you shouldn't look at. It's like this desire, it's something that takes over, and we know it's wrong and we know we shouldn't do it, but we continue to do it. That's what was happening to Samson. Samson had this desire that overtook him. That's the power that sex can have over us. Now, we know that sex is powerful, and we know in the right context it can be powerful, but in the wrong context, it can be powerful, but it can also be dangerous. And the way it's dangerous is it can control what we do, who we are, where, what we act out of doing. The people that we're with, it also can control them. So let's think about this. Let's talk about girls for a second. Girls think of sex like this. They think that when they're with a guy that he loves them. And in fact, in the surveys that we did, and I don't know if this was a girl that wrote this, but I would imagine that, we passed out those surveys last week. I think we had 40-something surveys. All the surveys in there but two said sex was designed for marriage. Okay? Two of them said sex was okay if you're in love. All right? Now, okay, love is part of it. Love has to be part of it. All right? Hopefully, you know, when you get married, you're in love with the person that you have sex with. But here's the scary thing about it is, this was a 14-year-old that wrote this. At 14 years old, do you really know what love is? I mean, because here's the deal. You know, how many people that are 14, 15, 16-year-old have even decided what college they're going to go to? How many people know what they're even going to wear the next day? Or what sport you're going to play? Or what movie you're going to go see? Like, at that age, you're having a hard enough time figuring out life and what life is, much less who you're going to spend the rest of your life with. But see, girls think differently than guys. Girls think if you're dating them, you're going to marry them. They do. If you ask a girl that you're dating or you're going to date, what do you think about Daniel? She'll say, he's the love of my life.
It's an evil thing, boys.
That's what girls will say. Girls will say that because here's the deal. They believe it. And it's nothing against girls. It doesn't mean they're naive. But girls think with emotion. Boys think physically. Remember we talked about it last week. That guys play football. Girls don't. Guys are physical by nature. All right. And I'm not saying that there aren't girls out there that are physical by nature. There are. But guys are physical. They like to feel good physically. They like to do physical things. Girls like emotional things. Have you ever gone to a movie with a girl, right? And what movies do they mostly want to go see? What kind of flick do you call it? Chick flick, right? What do guys like to go see? They like to go see things getting blown up and destroyed, and they like to go see football movies or whatever it might be. A lot of girls like to go see chick flicks. There's not a ton of girls. Now, there may be a few that like to go see these blow them up type movies. Yeah, they think differently. Girls think differently than boys. And so a girl thinks that you're going to spend the rest of your life with her. And if you have sex with her, she absolutely thinks that you're going to spend the rest of your life with her. No girl wakes up at 14 or 15 and says, I want to have sex with as many guys as I can. No girl starts that way. Now, they may start to go that way. They don't start that way. But what happens is, what makes a girl go that way is that some guy had sex with her, broke up with her, and she thought, well, I've got to find that right guy now. Now, guys, this is how guys think. They love the physical. I've never met a boy at 15 years old that's dating a girl or 16 years old and says, "This is my future wife." Now, you might think that. But very rarely would a guy admit that publicly. Because his buddies would say, "Wow, man, you're whooped," or, "Oh, yeah, yeah, she's got you around her little finger. You do everything that she wants to do." You know, much a lot like Amandrud. She does everything that you want her to do. You spend all your time with her. Right? That's what the buddies would say. So very rarely will a guy say, "This is the girl I'm going to spend the rest of my life with." But you know what she's telling all of her friends? "This is the guy I'm going to spend the rest of my life with." So when a guy wants to feed his desire for physical oneness and physical gratification, he preys on this conscious desire for the girl to feel valued and loved. And I'm not saying that all guys are out there, and not the guys in this room or the guys watching this are out there saying, "Yes, I prey on girls." I'm not saying you do that at all. I'm not saying you do that. But subconsciously, guys will feed their desire quicker than girls will. We will. You watch guys. If you want a video game, what do? You go buy the video game. That's what you do, right? If you want something, you go get it. That's how guys are impulse, man. They go. Girls don't operate like that. Girls are not impulsive in relationships. Because if you're dating a girl and you think, "Man, I got lucky," let me tell you something. She surveyed the landscape before she decided to go out with you. And it may have just happened that the landscape didn't look that good, and so she chose you. All right? And then when she chooses you, I'm not talking to you, Amandrud. When she chooses you, don't get so big on yourself and say, "You know, I'm a catch. You just happened by the process of elimination to be caught." But girls are meticulous in how they choose who they're going to be with. Guys are not. By nature, guys are not. Now, what's cool is there's many guys that you know and I know, and many guys that we all know that are saying, "Well, that's not me. Like, I'm going to wait for that perfect girl." And that's cool. But understand this, temptation will come. And temptation will play upon your heart. And temptation will play upon your desire to seek out physically. Because whether or not you're seeking out a girl, when you turn on the television or you turn on your computer, sex is there. We have a rule in my house. Now, I'm almost 45 years old. But we have a rule in my house. And when we're watching TV, if a Victoria's Secret commercial comes on, or a swimsuit edition, or a TV show, we change the channel. Now, I'm married. I'm 45. I love my wife. I have no desire to be with anybody else but herself. But my wife and I are smart enough to know that if I don't train my eyes to look away, they will latch on to whatever is there. Because remember what we've talked about many times in here, and I don't want to get too ultra spiritual with you and get way out there, but you know, we have to all come to the conclusion that there is an enemy. Okay? If there's good, there is evil in the world. And the enemy, as I've told you before, and if you haven't heard this, I want you to listen to this very closely. If you have heard this, you probably need to hear it again. The enemy is not out to hurt you. Not out to maim you, not out to wound you. The enemy is out to destroy you and me. And he will do whatever he has to do, and he knows with guys, the best way to destroy is through physical desire. And you might say, "Well, listen, I'm a virgin, and I'm going to wait, and I'm not going to do that." Let me explain something to you. He will attack your computer, the television, the media. He will do anything he can to destroy you. Have you ever thought it's kind of weird that you, let's say that you have been struggling with something sexually, and you say, "Man, I'm really going to try and stop doing this." All right, and you're making a concerted effort, and you're really building up this strength, man, and you've got some momentum going, and you're starting to feel good about yourself. You're like, "This is awesome." And then all of a sudden, you're watching something on TV, and boom! boom, there it is. Or you go to school, and there's this girl that just happened to wear that outfit that day, and it changed your whole perception. Immediately, all this hard work and effort you feel like you had been doing with the Lord was just, boom, taken away from you. You think that's coincidence? It's not coincidence. The enemy knows. The enemy knows your weakness and knows my weakness. And he's out to destroy you. He's out to make you sleep with every girl you can, to watch every piece of pornography you can, to get you to become so perverted sexually that that's all you think about. And in fact, you get to the point to where you, all you think about is that, and you feel so guilty about it that then the guilt controls you. And then you start to tell yourself, well, I'm not worthy to be a Christian, or I'm not worthy to be so-and-so's boyfriend, or I'm not worthy to be so-and-so's friend because I hold this secret inside of me and I'm so guilty of it. And then he says, this is it, man. I'm going to take him apart brick by brick. Pornography is actually, to me, worse than the act of sex, and I think they're both bad, but here's where pornography gets you. Pornography is puts you in a whole different stratosphere here. It's fake. Like, think about that. If you ever look at pornography or you watch something that you shouldn't be watched that's pornographic, it's fake. It's not even reality. It's not even the real world. If you had never looked at pornography ever before, didn't really know what it was, and somebody came to you and said, hey man, you'll never guess what I did last night. I watched this, I had sex with this beautiful woman. Really? Tell me about her. Well, she was awesome, unbelievable figure, beautiful. Man, it was the greatest night of my life. Well, when can I meet her? Well, go to this website and check her out. Really, is that a picture of her? No, I mean, like, I've never met her. I just viewed her, and we had sex together. Somebody, they would look at you like you were the weirdest person in the world. Now, think about that. Think about that. Yeah, they would say, what are you talking about? But that's the world that we live in, see? It's so easy to get to that stuff, but it's not real. You know the person that you're looking at, and they have no idea who you are. There's no connection at all. You have an emotional attachment to them. They have no emotional attachment to you. I did research one time for a paper I had to do, and I was part of the research was I was looking into the background of these ladies who get into pornography. All right? 85% of them have some sort of disconnect with their family, or they've been molested or raped, or something's happened in their life so traumatic that it's caused them to turn to this because they are looking for love. They're looking for love. They're looking for love. Women in the porn industry would tell you that they have sex because it's enjoyable. They would say that publicly, but there have been private research and documents written that say they hate it. But they're so involved in it, they don't know how to get out, that it makes them feel loved and valued, that they at least have a place in the world that they can't get out of it. But as guys, we're drawn to that. And actually, if you think about it, we're actually disrespecting them by buying into it. The porn industry is one of the, it's a billion-dollar business. So pornography is as bad or if not worse. And for guys, we attach ourselves to that desire. Because as a guy, we're going to get what we want. There's this sense of conquering. Samson, think about Samson. Here's this big, burly, strong guy. Do you not think that he felt like, man, he had conquered Delilah? In fact, not even conquered her. He had conquered the Philistines. Guys want to conquer. Girls want to be loved. It's this sex-love trade-off that we have. If you think about it, it's so kind of warped in the way it's meant to be because girls want to be loved, so they have sex. Guys want to love a girl and make her feel loved, so they have sex with her. So we trade off love for sex. I think the problem that we have is not that we don't understand sex. I think we're getting a pretty clear picture of that. I don't think we understand love. That's the problem I think we have. There's a lot of guys that don't know how to love properly. And for the most part, most of the time, it's because our dad didn't teach us how to love properly. So we've had no influence, male influence, to learn what true, healthy love is about. So when a girl's attracted to us and she falls in love with us, we think, well, that must be love. I mean, and then having sex, you know, we have love. And then she says to you after sex, I love you. And you don't want her to feel weird. So you say, well, I love you too. And maybe in some way you do feel it. But let me tell you something. As a guy, I mean, I know when I was your age, I had no clue what that was. I didn't know what that was. I had a girlfriend. I thought I loved her. But I can tell you this, there were a lot of other girls that liked me, and there are a lot of other girls I liked. But not for her. She liked me, and just me. And she loved me. And she told all of her friends she was going to marry me. And we were 15 years old. 15. I probably at that point couldn't spell the word Mary. I had no idea what that even really meant outside that I knew my parents were married. But she knew. And so what did I do as a guy? I used that. I used the power of that to get what I wanted. And did I marry her? No. In fact, I was with dozens and dozens of other girls past her and beyond her that too also thought they were going to marry me. Now, I'm not saying guys are all bad, but we think differently than girls do. And we've got to get to a point where we're not taking advantage of them. Now, girls can take advantage of the situation too. They can use our physical weakness against us, just like Delilah did. Samson wasn't all bad here. Remember, Delilah played and preyed upon him. She used her manipulation to get him to do and say and act in ways that weren't natural for him. She knew. And the enemy does the same thing. I'm no dummy. Listen, we've spent 2 weeks talking about sex. We'll talk about it again next week. You're going to go home saying, I need to figure this out. I need to stop doing what I'm doing. I don't want to do this anymore. But you're going to be overcome. You're going to be weak. There's going to be a weak point that's going to hit you that's going to be hard for you to do. It's going to be hard for you to resist. And as most guys do, we don't have any accountability partners in our life, so we don't have anybody to help hold us accountable. I have a buddy of mine that had an addiction to pornography, and he got another friend of his to hold him accountable, and they put this program on his computer that would alert his buddy anytime he was looking at something he shouldn't look at. So the dude would call him. You know, what are you looking at, man? What's going on here? And they built this relationship to where my buddy, who was addicted to pornography, would start calling him anytime he had the desire to look at it. And they would pray it through and talk it through. And then it got less and less and less. And now he has no issues with it. See, a girl, if she's having problems with sex, most of the time will go talk to somebody about it. Guys, it's not the manly thing to do. Why would I talk? It's embarrassing. I don't want anybody to know that I look at pornography. That's dirty. That's ugly. In fact, I think guys think actually looking at pornography is uglier than the act of having sex. Guys will brag about having sex. How many guys do you know that brag about looking at porn? You ever met a guy who walks around school going, dude, you want to guess what I did last night, man? I looked at pages and pages of pornography. And everybody's high-fiving each other. You very rarely see that. But you will see a guy go and say, man, I slept with so-and-so last night. It was awesome, man. She did this. And the guys are like, dude, that's awesome. That's great, man. Welcome. You're in the club. Listen to this statement. We treat virtual girls that we'll never meet in our life with more respect than the girls that we hang out with, that we physically are in relationships with. We would rather tell people that we had a physical, out of wedlock, inappropriate sexual encounter with a girl that everybody knows than we would about some girl tens of thousands of megabytes away that we'll never meet in our life. But we would never tell anybody about that. That's the stronghold and power that sex has. It makes us do and say things. I mean, think about that statement I just said. Just sitting here, everybody would say, man, that is messed up. That is messed up. But people do it. People do it. And why? Because sex has the power. Now, here's the cool thing. This is how God works into the equation. The cool thing is, regardless of your circumstances, regardless of where you are, there's hope, okay? You can change your ways. And Samson even did this. If you read further in Judges, what Samson did is that he repented of his sin. He knew what had happened. In fact, he had his eyes gouged out. He couldn't even see. And he asked God for forgiveness and strength. And God renewed his strength. See, if you have a relationship with Jesus, it doesn't matter how bad it gets. You can go and say, I just need more strength. I need more strength. Now, here's what he's going to tell you. You need somebody to help you. You need some accountability. And if you're not willing to get the accountability, then it's going to be hard for me to give you the strength, because you're going to allow your desire to overcome what I'm trying to do. God's all about the supernatural, and he's all about giving you supernatural strength. But the problem is that we allow other things to overcome us. And it's kind of the way our spiritual life works anyways. We say, you know, where is God? We can't trust God. But we almost do more what the enemy wants us to do than what God wants us to do. So you got to have help. You got to get help. You have to have accountability. In fact, I'd go this far, man. I know guys that do this. If I see a girl wearing something inappropriate at school or something, I'd go up and tell her, man, you got to stop wearing that stuff. First of all, it's not valuing you as a woman, because you know how guys are looking at you? For a girl to wear something inappropriate, she's completely taking anything of value out of her life. If it's too tight or too loose or shows too much skin, no guy looks at her and goes, God, that's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. No, they look at her and say, my gosh, that's sexy. My gosh, look at her. My gosh, I wonder what she looks like without that on. Is that truly what girls want in their life? I'd go up to a girl and I'd say, you got to stop wearing that. That's messing with my eyes. You know what that's doing to me, and then you know what that's doing to you? If your buddies start bragging about having sex with somebody, the next question I would say, are you going to marry that girl? Are you going to marry that girl? Because you realize now that when she gets married, if you're not going to marry her, that when she has sex with her husband, that now you're a part of that? That now you're a part of that marriage, and you're a part of that union? And every time she has sex with her husband, guess what? You're a part of that. Forever and ever. I don't know about you. I can only handle one wife and one relationship. But you know, I don't want to be connected to all these other different women. But I am. I'll just admit that to you publicly. I am. I had sex with many women before my wife. And I'm connected to every single one of those women for the rest of my life. That's power. That's serious power. And that's what sex does to us. Until you take a stand against it, the enemy will continue to use its power against you and will use the power for bad, not good. What's really cool about sex, though, when you get married, is it can really create some awesome things. Like, most of you know my kids. I have two great, awesome kids because of the good part of sex, that we were able to create two awesome kids. Your parents, when they were married, they created you. That's awesome. That's awesome. I mean, it's not cool to think about, I know, but that's the power it has. That's the power it has. It has the power for good. And that's how it's to be used. It's like having the 22 rifle. You can do a lot of damage with a 22 rifle. But I know all of you guys, you're not walking around with weapons wanting to do evil. You enjoy using them. You go out and kill animals or food or target practice or whatever you do. But have you not read in the news at these schools and at these places where these guys use these weapons for evil, right? It's the power of the weapon. So what's our biggest debate in the country right now is gun control. But understand this. As bad as guns are and can be used as evil, sex has the same power. $1 billion is a lot of money. The porn industry is a $1 billion business. There are more kids being born out of wedlock than ever before. There are more teenagers having sex than ever before because the culture tells us it's okay.